All right, great. Item B is Department of Roads overview. Bryan Santo, our new director. Good afternoon, Bryan.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Or should I should say good evening.
You know, you're with the most popular department, you know.
everywhere
I go, people talk about you. Or about the roads, anyway.
A good thing or a bad thing?
That's kind of our hazing right now, so forgive me. I just couldn't resist.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to present Department of Roads' brief overview. Once again, my name is Bryan Santo, Director of Department of Roads. I've got Vince Viviano, my Chief of Staff, here also with me. If you could look through your agenda items, you should be able to follow through along with the PowerPoint presentation that's in front of you. Just a little bit going to the basics. Michigan, obviously the 10th largest total road system in the U.S. with just over 122,000 miles. Fourth largest local road system in the U.S. with just over 89,000 miles. Michigan roads move about $860 billion in goods per year. In particular, Macomb County, population of just over 854,000, third highest in Michigan. Sixth largest road system in Michigan with just over 1,700 miles. 27 cities, townships, and villages. As far as funding for our roads, we get our road money from Michigan Transportation Funds, which come from gas taxes and weight taxes. Funding for that split is a little over 39% for MDOT, a little over 39% for county road agencies, and cities, villages get just under 22%. Obviously, the gas tax was just recently raised, start of 2017, 7.3 cents to get us to 26.3 cents per gallon. Obviously, the popular belief is that property taxes go towards road funding, and that's obviously just not the case. So, basically a projection of that additional monies projected out through 2024. Obviously, we just started getting in revenues. We're basically 2 months behind, so we're just starting to realize the January projections, and they are coming in with what we had projected, but that's determined by state legislature continuing on with what they had expressed to us as far as the funding levels, that they don't take from that funding and disperse it elsewhere. So that is the projected increases over the next few years. As far as jurisdiction over roads, obviously state roads are the I roads, the M roads, and the US roads, I-696, 94, M-59. County roads, primary roads, Metro Parkway and Mound as an example. Local roads, Card Road, 27 Mile Road. Within the townships, all roads in the townships are county jurisdiction, except for private roads and state trunk lines. And once again, townships do not receive MTF funds. Cities and villages have jurisdiction over their own interior roads. Usually the, some north-south roads, Hoover, Ryan, and all residential streets. Cities do receive MTF funds under their jurisdiction. As far as federal funding obviously is through gas tax of 18.4 cents per gallon. And 24.4 cents per gallon for diesel. About three quarters of our federal funding is distributed to states and a quarter is split between county and road agencies. Federal funds for a lot of our projects is 80% participation on the federal funding side. And between us and the communities, we make up the remaining 20%. As far as TIP projections, TIP projects projected out for 3 to 4 years, that's Transportation Improvement Program. Basically a project scheduled through 2020. That is determined as far as the project allocations by a federal aid committee, which consists of representatives from SEMCOG, MDOT, Department of Roads, and basically township, cities, and villages within the county. There's a call for projects. Those projects are reviewed, and then a determination is made as far as what projects move forward as far as that type of federal funding. Just to give you an idea of some of our upcoming construction projects, major 2017 construction projects, we have one underway currently, which is North Avenue from M-59 to 21 Mile Road. It's a widening from 2-lane to 5-lane. We do have some upcoming projects on Shaner, Garfield, Southbound Mound, overlay and gravel to asphalt paving, Fairchild and Omo. We do have some bridges in box culverts, 28 and 29 mile road, that are up and coming for this year. So we do have a healthy program coming up as a road department. As far as our road maintenance on the on that end of it in perspective, we maintain approximately a little over 1,700 miles of primary road and about 210 miles of state trunk line. Obviously, we're busy with maintenance requests with a little under 8,400 total service requests in 2016. We have four service centers, Washington, New Haven, Clinton, and Shelby. As far as our winter operations, unfortunately, we're getting a little dose of that here currently. We do have 66 snow routes, 75 heavy-duty salt trucks equipped with GPS. We have brine makers at each of our service centers as far as producing, you know, up to 3,000 gallons of brine per hour. We try and put that on, obviously, in preparation. Brine mixed with this boost product that's MDOT approved works better in the colder temperatures that are below freezing in preparation for, you know, the snow plows to come through. It works better as a de-icing agent with below zero temperatures. It makes the salt more effective. We do have, obviously, after-hours patrols, maintain straight trunk lines and any emergency efforts as far as pothole requests and stuff like that. Just a little bit tidbits of information. Last year, maintenance crews used over 12,700 tons of patching material at a cost of about $500,000, 33 tons of crack fill material at a cost of just over $27,000. Once again, like I said, during the winter months, we run after hours crews, taking care of the snow and ice conditions and emergency pothole repairs. Some of our other programs, Commissioner Brown's aware of, we do have a limestone program for the northern townships, six townships. It says 2 to 3, but since 2012 or 13, I think we've pretty much been doing 3 miles per township per year. It's been a great program. As far as a look at our maintenance by township, as you can see on the left side in the red, that's the actual funds that we actually received per year. And on the right hand side, that's the actual expenditures per year for each township. So I think traditionally all but two, we're spending obviously more maintenance expense dollars than we receive, obviously as a need per township, so, which is a good thing. Another section of our Department of Roads is our Traffic and Operations Center. Basically, it's just with traffic control devices. We deal with crash analysis, traffic volumes, signal maintenance records and analysis. We do traffic impact analysis for new development and basically the liaison with other transportation agencies, federal and state funding, and other stakeholders that we deal with. Oh.
My graduation picture.
Don't get Marv in there. With his new car.
Exactly. We have basically just over 740 traffic signals and obviously 1,700 road miles, 50,000 plus signs, and some of the obviously home to the big three and some of the other industrial centers. This is just basically a culmination of kind of what we do on the traffic operations side to traffic engineering safety, traffic planning, administration, traffic operations, and traffic control device maintenance. There's a multitude of things that the Traffic Operations Center does, and fortunate to have a great staff that is able to make us look good on that end of the spectrum. So in the future, if any one of the commissioners would like to come in and tour the Traffic Operations Center, recommended. I think you'd be impressed with what we have over there. It's at the leading edge, and actually, for a county agency, it's one of the leaders in the country as far as our Traffic Operations Center. So very, very proud of that. Just give you an idea of some of the traffic volumes. And obviously, we're doing some work on, or the state is doing some work on M59. Actually, that has more of a traffic volume than I-94 does in a daily basis. But some of the other roads that we see, Mound Road, getting 66,000 plus vehicle miles or vehicles per day. So we have some significant traffic volumes on our Macomb County roads. Obviously, we look at dealing with traffic congestion, you know, look at building additional lanes, look at incident management. You know, we try and manage planned events to best suit traffic and traffic control and relieve congestion, monitor signal performances, and basically look at, you know, new edge technology to better manage our traffic flows, which I'll get to later as far as some examples of that. We have about 735 traffic signal locations, and on average, there's probably about 22 electronic devices per intersection in those locations. We have 590 locations, which is about 80%, that are able to communicate back to our ComTech building. We're working on making that 100% in the near future here. We actually have about 219 traffic monitoring cameras that do have live feeds that come back to our traffic operations center. Have full capability of you know, viewing those cameras, manipulating the camera to view different angles in different directions, and that those are direct live feeds through our traffic operations center. Basically, this is a snapshot of our ComTech layout. We have the traffic operations center, which is up front. Then we have Sheriff's Dispatch 911 Center. And then we have the Emergency Operations Center as part of that facility. McDoor maintains all MDOT signals. Basically, staff coordinates with local and state MDOT engineers on timings and stuff like that. Worked with MDOT has a Southeastern Michigan Traffic Operations Center that we coordinate with. On a daily basis, basically. You know, we hold regional workshops, incident management training, and procedures also coordinated between both centers. Some of the stakeholders, local municipalities, McDoor obviously established relationships with these local municipalities to work with our traffic operations center as far as a need basis. City engineers for construction projects, you know, we help out in that facility. Holding bi-weekly and internally with our projects, we hold bi-weekly internal meetings to discuss progress of construction projects that we have. We work with obviously local law enforcement with the 911 dispatch in the traffic operations center. You know, currently in future, obviously working with that entity, you know, as best to make things more efficient in the future for them also. Future planning, obviously we have further advances in safety. Data collection is a big thing with traffic data and its uses. One of the things I mentioned previously as far as present day or current day advances, connected vehicle program. We've been working with GM on a connected vehicle program. We have three intersections along Mountain Road Corridor that we're working with them on that are active. And the basic connected vehicle means that the vehicle communicates with the signal and it knows basically when the signal timing is changing. So if you're approaching, you know, say an intersection and it's going to turn red and turns red, and say the driver isn't aware of it, isn't paying attention, the car will actually, and I sat in a test drive with GM, it actually vibrate your seat, you know, put a warning symbol up on your GPS screen, and to let you know that, you know, you're approaching a red stop light and you're in close proximity that you might drive through it. So it's a warning device. It also has to do with advancements as far as the construction projects. If there's a lane drop and you're in the lane that's dropping, it'll give you advance notice on your screen and through your seat, as far as vibrating your seat, to let you know that your lane's dropping. So it's all good stuff. It is the future, and we're planning on that as far as our intersections and working with the community on those efforts. So good stuff. Just some more stuff about connected vehicles, some information. It has to do with EMS, fire, and freight also, as far as working with signals and intersections and best to efficiently get freight, even on Mound Road, we're looking at a Mound Road corridor initiative to get freight travel more efficient and more timely. So that's a benefit, obviously, to the infrastructure in the community. Basically, that's what I have for you as far as overview. You know, I know you know there's subsequent information as far as our concerns moving forward. You know, some things we'd like to see from state legislator, state and federal legislation. Obviously, we're dealing currently with the 15 Mile Road sinkhole, working through MDOT and FHWA, Federal Highway Administration, to see if we can come up with some funding, assist with the road repair for that. So we're actively working through MDOT. Just had a meeting this past earlier in the week to look at that and moving forward with hopefully some participation from Federal Highway as far as emergency relief funding to help out that situation. You know, we had some stuff in the retirement healthcare funding as far as requirements that were proposed as a House bill requiring that we be 80% funded, or we would have to pass on the percentage of the cost to the actual workers. That information is seen in the pamphlet also with what you have in your agenda items. One thing that's as far as the County Road Association of Michigan is dealing with currently, I know Genesee County's actually, I think, been sued by some of the telecommunications companies. I know Oakland County is very concerned, as are we, as far as the telecommunication companies want to utilize our right-of-way. I think that they're a public utility to come in, put in huge 100-foot towers, which obviously is a safety issue. They want minimal costs associated with that. You know, we're not a revenue generation out of our permits department, but we need to cover our costs for those facilities coming into our right-of-way. And they want minimal costs, and that would be borne as far as the costs onto the Department of Roads and the county ultimately for those costs. So there's a proactive effort to, you know, petition the FCC to not allow for that to happen as far as the telecommunications companies. And just some of the other, we are part of obviously the CRAM, County Road Association of Michigan. And as you can see, there's a long laundry list of wants as far as, you know, Act 51 needs study, maybe a look at the distribution formula, looking at trying to get more funding, more money for local government counties, you know, alternative dollars other than gas tax. You know, currently, I think the additional money that we're getting as the additional gas tax is being put into the general fund of the state, but we'd like to see that actually put into somewhere that's more concrete, that it's guaranteed that we get the money instead of just the general fund appropriation that's currently in place. If there's anything else, thank you for your time. If there's any questions.
Yes, there are. Commissioner Majak.
Well, first of all, I'll just make a receive and file motion to get that going out of the way. Right. Bryan and Vince, thank you very
much. Commissioner Carabelli supported that.
Thank you very much for coming here, gentlemen. I've had a lot of constituent requests and concerns over the years. Road department has generally done a good job. A lot of the stuff I've had to deal with is traffic lights, see if there's enough traffic to warrant a part-time light or full-time light. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate the department's help. Hoffner and Sue Van Steele. She's always been very helpful and taking my calls right away. And my constituents talked a lot with a lot of the some of the engineers at your office. So thank you guys for that and pass that down.
Sure.
So we all know that in Michigan there's a shortage in infrastructure needs. The governor's came out with the numbers of $4 billion a year for the next 5 years, I believe. And a lot of that money would be for infrastructure, sewers, and roads, mainly, as I understand it. And I know that infrastructure needs is a very high priority on the voters' minds. So just a couple questions here. Mike, did you control the slides of that, or did he?
He did. Put them back up.
Yeah, if you could put up the fourth one, which says MTF revenues, I appreciate that.
Right, wow. We'll be able to control it.
Okay.
So while he's doing that, so a question to you, Bryan. So the state gas tax is currently 26.3 cents per gallon. Does all of that go to roads and or road construction, or some of that goes to education? I really don't know. That's why I'm asking you. Because you mentioned it. You mentioned yourself. I'll let you.
You're talking the one title, funding for roads? Stop.
Yeah, I guess that would be the third slide, funding for roads.
Michigan Transportation Funds.
So if you look here, you mentioned to me here that recently increased 7.3 cents per gallon general fund, right? And you just told us that you hope that that would be more concrete or dedicated to road construction.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so my question to you is just looking at this state gas tax, 26.3 cents, does that all go to roads or not?
Yes. I believe that the whole 26.3 cents.
Leon, I gotta defer to Leon. You served in the legislature.
10% goes to our mass transit off the top, up to 10%.
So some of that 26 goes to, you said, mass transit?
Yeah, it's currently at 8%, but it could go up to 10% toward mass transit.
Okay, so we can agree that this 26.3 cents gas tax, it's not all to road construction. It goes to MDOT,
all
and that's.
Transit and
okay, thank you. Second question would pertain to. One, two, three slides later for federal funding. Federal funding gas tax 18.4 cents per gallon. How much, I'm a little bit confused about that. So then how much of that is divvied up to road construction? Or it says here, you know, a lot of it goes to the states. And then, so can you explain to me the flow process with the federal taxes, if you know that?
I mean, whatever federal taxes receive, you know, per gallon, three quarters of that is distributed to the state, and about a quarter of that is split up between the counties.
Okay, so it goes to the state being MDOT.
Yes.
And then from MDOT, what do they do with the federal money? Does that go to, like, yes?
Before it goes down to the counties, it goes to SEMCOG and the different things before it comes to you, correct, the counties?
Yes, I mean.
Okay.
I just want to distribute it. Yeah. I mean,
So explain that. So it goes from the federal government to where SEMCOG, and then from SEMCOG to.
If you look at the slide right after that, the TIP and the FAC, basically the TIP, Transportation Improvement Program, is the disbursement of the federal funds.
Okay.
So there's a committee of SEMCOG, MDOT, road departments in township, cities, and villages that meet, and they have a multitude of call for projects or projects that are submitted to gain access to this federal money.
So the projects that would be submitted for those funds, they could be a city road, a county road, a township road, all the above. It doesn't have to be like I-75 and I-94.
If they're federal aid qualifying, yes, they could be submitted for a project.
For all those things.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's projected out, obviously, to 2020.
Okay,
currently.
Very good. Thank you. Now, can we go back two slides, MTF revenues, please? There you go. Okay, so if you go back to 2016, $42 million, it seems like that's where we were at before this 7 cents increase took place. Am I correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes, correct.
And so when we go, so 2017 is the start of this new gas tax increase.
Yes.
All the way through to 2021. So if I do my math correctly, from 2016 to 2021, that is $27 million over 5 years, correct? Approximately.
Actually, it's,
yes.
If you're looking at $42 million as a baseline,
uh-huh.
You know, obviously 2017 is an increase of about $7 million. 2018, from the $42 million is an increase of about $12 million. Then it jumps to $15.5 million. Then about $20 million, and then $24 million.
Okay.
So
it's, my
it's, so it's, you know, the net increase over 5 years is 44, 56, 63, 73, about 78, 79 million.
Okay. So my question to you would be, over this 5 year period with this increase, where does that leave Macomb County roads? Does that mean that, is that enough to do construction on roads in Macomb County that's going to get us to a position where our roads will be in a good position, you know?
Well, obviously, this is a great start, Commissioner right. Majak. Is it a fix-all, end-all, be-all? No. I mean, unfortunately, Michigan roads, as well as our roads, have been lacking as far as funding for quite a few years and decades. You know, this money will be applied to roadways to get the overall average condition up on our Macomb County roads, and we'll be able to put more of that revenue into our roads to improve that. You know, systematically over time, like I said, we're just starting to realize those funds currently. And that's to say that all those funds stay at those levels as projected and they don't take that funding
because
elsewhere.
That's never hit, because we don't know, because it's sometimes you can't trust other government entities. Revenue sharing, you don't know what's going to happen. A promise is made 20 years ago and we're short. It seems that's the trend, you know.
If
I hope I'm wrong, but
if there's an emergency need that they determine somewhere else.
Let me ask you this. So after 2021, then it's always going to keep increasing like that then? Or is that going to flatten out after 2021?
As far as my understanding is that will flatten out.
Okay. So then in your professional opinion, you're a civil engineer, is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. What would be a preferable amount of money that we can have? If I was God and I said, Bryan, here you go, I'm going to give you money to get our roads to be in a good condition over the next 5 years. And you said, okay, this is how much I would need. In your professional opinion, I know it's a guess, and I don't mean to put you on the spot. I just want to get a feel of, no, here's the question is was that enough of what the state did? Is 7.3 cents increase enough? Because you look at the slide before that, I mean, there's a problem there. It was increased in 1984, and it was increased in 1997, and increased 20 years later. I mean, I think
that's an unfair question to ask the department head, because he doesn't speak for Macomb County. I don't think that's a. Well, obviously we know. So what do you?
Do you care to answer that or no? I mean, if you don't know, you don't know.
I mean, I don't have a number. I can spit out. I can tell you that, you know, obviously. My belief is that money is a good start, but it's not enough to get us within 5 years of having all good roads.
Yeah. Okay, so let me ask you another question here. So,
we have 5 minutes per commissioner. So,
okay, well,
many commissioners on the list.
Okay, I'll be done now. So, where would, in your professional opinion, if you don't want to answer this, that's fine as well.
I'm trying to be polite.
Given that there are different government entities that provide funding for roads, you know. I mean, the city passed a millage for such and so on and so forth. Which level of government is dropping the ball in terms of us not having the money for roads? Is it the state level or the federal level? It would seem to be one of those two, or all the above. The whole country not investing enough in infrastructure as a priority.
I would probably say in general, the culmination of all entities.
Okay.
Thank you, Commissioner Majak.
Okay, I guess that's all I have. I know you want to cut me off there.
We have, I will say 5 minutes per commissioner, and it's been five minutes. I've been given great latitude. So
here's the thing, though, just to finish. I've met voters a long time over the years, over 20 years, and I've never, ever, ever heard voters in masses want to pay more in taxes for anything ever, except when it's come to roads. And I'm hearing it more and more. Voters tell me they destroyed, you know, $400 in their car. A voter last year said he spent $1,900 on their car, and I've heard that a lot. And voters are frustrated, and I'm frustrating too. And it's not rocket science. I just think there's a financially structural problem there, because it is a money issue. I really do. It's not perfect. We can build our roads better, like the way the Germans do, and so on and so forth. But until you solve the money part, you know, we're going to continue to have road problems. Thank you for coming here today. Thank you,
thank
Mr.
you,
Chair.
I appreciate
thank
it.
You,
thank
Commissioner
you. Mayor. Commissioner Carabelli, you have 1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Real quick, Bryan, what would you prefer us commissioners? In the past, when Bob was there, I would have an issue with a constituent, and I would call Bob, and I would leave a message with Sue. Sue would ask what it is. And at the end of the day, I figured the real answer out. Sue's the lady to take care of business.
She's very good at what she does.
So
yes.
Would you recommend that if we have issues is to call your office and let Sue know the situation? Because I found it, and I don't want to speak on behalf of your office, to give us direction on what do you recommend for us to do?
Yes, I would recommend that.
I'm using the office, but depending on meetings and schedules, yes, Sue is very, very good at what she does as far as information, you know, getting it to the appropriate department or person as far as the inquiry.
As far as follow-up as well.
Yes, and she, yes, she's very, very, very good at that.
Just wanted to get that out there. Second thing is now comes a little tougher questions.
Okay.
In budget seasons.
Yes.
In the budget season, you were here with the former director.
Mm-hmm.
And we approved several individuals to be placed into your department.
Mm-hmm.
And what that's, Mr. Garibelli.
During the budget season, the Board of Commissioners approved a budget for several new hires in your department. With that said, I made a strong opinion saying that the crack sealing program needs to be expanded from what you currently do to help all the issues that we have today of trying to prolong 5 to 10 years per road so that the situation everybody's concerned of the bad roads, we can make them last longer.
Correct.
Where are we today in that program as it started, have these employees been hired? Are we in the process of doing this?
We are in the process of hiring. As a part of the bidding process, you know, we do the internal bidding, so there's people that are moving from position to position, whether it's an advancement or a lateral transfer. So as far as realizing extra personnel from what we had previously, we haven't gotten to that point yet because of all the internal bidding process. So we will get to that point. Obviously, HR is working through that currently and dealing with, you know, all the position moves and stuff like that. So until all that solidifies as far as all those positions being taken at the different service centers, then once the lower level positions are opened up, then it'll go to the outside, you know, for new hires, basically. So
is it still the intent that when you have those new hires that the program, the crack sealing or filling is going to be expanded so that we can save our roads a little longer?
Yes. Obviously, more and more we're moving to, you know, the capacity jobs going from a 2-lane to a 3-lane or 2-lane to a 5-lane. You know, there's less and less roads to do that to. It is tougher to get a multitude of those projects out just with environmental assessment through the federal highway that take more and more time, it seems like. Through property acquisitions, right-of-way acquisitions that take longer. So we are looking at more of a function of maintenance and extending the life of decent pavements so they don't deteriorate enough where it requires reconstruction versus a rehab. And we are looking at, I just talked to County Highway Engineer Walt Schell just recently as far as, you know, setting up a crack sealant program in the future here as far as prolonging the life of pavements, for sure.
And that's, again, that's one of the reasons why as a commissioner voted yes, because mm-hmm. of expanding of that program to save our, add 10 years to a life of a road. I thought that was a no-brainer.
I mean, the public doesn't care for the aesthetics of it, but functionality-wise, you know, it definitely extends the life, seals the cracks, prevents water from getting down in the cracks, freeze-thaw cycles, so yes.
Okay, and the very last question, Mr. Chairman, is that I know you have that special computer in your car, so as you drive up to the lights and they change for you, and I was wondering if we could get one of those.
You want one to turn it green, too?
Thank you, Commissioner Carabelli. Commissioner Romano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I wish I had the same praise for your predecessor as Mr. Myjack did, but I didn't. But I have to tell you this, first time that I've called Mr. Sanchez's office, believe it or not, he called me back. And I think he knew from my tone that I was so totally impressed I wanted to bow down and kiss his feet. This has never happened. And as again, I don't want to repeat myself, but you folks know I've been around a long time in Sterling Heights as a councilman, and I never had that kind of service from your predecessor. Having said that, I do have some questions for you.
Okay.
How many total employees do you have, Mr. Santos? Do you have that number?
We have approximately 245 to 250 employees.
Okay.
That includes administration, but majority of that, probably 235, is actual union employees.
Are different employees, I'm sure, allocated for different departments?
Yes, we have multiple departments, maintenance, traffic department, engineering department.
Okay. Here's where I'm getting at. You know, the meat and potatoes of this is, and I and there's no doubt in my mind, I hate to speak for all the rest of the commissioners, but I know that I will. We're getting calls from our constituents because of the roads. We all know that. We all know that. There's not, and they're raising hell with us. So my question is it to the point that you should maybe allocate more people to the road repair? And I guess my question would be, how many actually are on road repairs that you have out of these 245 or 50 employees?
Out of our maintenance department, we probably have 125, 130 maintenance workers. And, you know, obviously when this type of weather turns, when we have freeze thaw cycles, when we go from 70 to back to 20 and 15 and have the rains that we did, our forces are distributed to fix potholes on a daily basis, you know, and do whatever they can to make those roads traversable. Obviously, once the springtime comes around, we are looking at the worst sections to get programs and get projects in those locations. I know we're looking at Metro Parkway. We're looking at additional spots on Shaner. We're looking at Mound. Those are, you know, just a handful of the areas we're looking at that obviously there's a need. You know, I know there's a Mound Road corridor improvement plan that we're looking at, but there's a need now to do basic repairs in concrete patches to get to that point where we can actually reconstruct the road. So we are looking at providing maintenance to the roadways and putting that additional funding towards the maintenance and prolonging the life of those roads. So, I mean, there's an effort to do that.
Without trying to shorten the needs of my fellow commissioners, you mentioned three roads that are near and dear to my heart. You mentioned 16 Mile Road, Sterling Heights. You mentioned Mound Road, Sterling Heights. You mentioned Shaner, Sterling Heights. So you folks can imagine the number of calls that I'm getting because of that situation. So Sterling Heights a couple of years ago went out and bought a machine for, Bryan, I might put you on the spot. You're sleeping over there, but I might put you, for about $500,000, a sealant machine that they utilized. And from what I had seen, personally seen, the machine was working wonders, adverse to getting this coal patch, and all, with all due respect to the workers, dropping it in the hole and moving on. And then 30 cars run over it with their tire treads and pick up all that gravel, and then it's empty again. I know it's called job security, but I think it's, we used to have a machine that pounded that stuff in, and all of a sudden I don't see that machine. I got some more. I don't see that machine. The individual cities do our own. Sterling Heights gets out there, and we do it when we need to have it done, and I'm sure the Road Commission does what they have to do too, but I'd sure as hell like to see them do more. And I'm talking about road repair, guys, because we all hear it. The busted tires, the broken rims, and the people complaining. And you can't go anyplace without hearing it. This sealant that they use for the pothole, they do a pretty good job in Sterling Heights with that sealant machine. And maybe you can get into Sterling Heights and find more. I think you need to spend, I'm looking here at $27,000 for 33 tons of crack fill. Maybe you need to spend more on patch. I don't know how much you got there, but maybe you need to spend more. When somebody calls in, one of the commissioners here, or just a resident, and says to your office, I got a crater, and that's what they all describe it as, a crater that you can lose your car in. Mm-hmm. Everybody's got craters. So my question is, once that call comes into your department, is there a time frame that you try to allocate to repair that, or depending on the seriousness of it? Do you want pictures from us? And I can do that, as I'm sure all of my fellow commissioners can also do, to send to you. Tell us what you want us to do to make it easier for you to get the hot spots.
I mean, if there's severe enough potholes or, you know, whatever you want to call it, craters.
Yeah.
You know, we do try and get out the next day or the next service day, or if not that day. If it's a, you know, crater or pothole that's bad enough that it's causing.
I mean, I'll tell you, when they get calls like that, they're filled usually within 3 hours.
Okay. I'll take a day, 1 day or 2 days. I'll take that. So the machine that I mentioned that pounded the what do they call that stuff again? The black stuff.
Coal patch.
Coal patch. The machine that used to pound that in, whatever happened, they quit doing it?
I will look into that serviceability of that or the hours on that. At our maintenance, I think we have, do we have one or two of those?
Two of them.
I know we talked previously on the phone and discussed that in length and in as far as your opinion on job security. But, you know, our forces are put out to maximize coverage. And that piece of equipment only does so much area and so much time. In order to, obviously, you've expressed yourself the deterioration of some of those roads that I had mentioned. And to be able to go out and fill those. And yes, that's part of the process of filling them is the compaction is done with vehicles. But I mean, definitely can look at those programs, look at that process. You know, not going to use the skateboard, but looking at those currently taking over the Department of Roads and looking at hopefully improving upon some of those processes and procedures, so.
Without getting into your exact address, may I ask what municipality you live in?
I live in the village of New Haven.
So New Haven, so you take?
Hall Road to 94 to
okay, just,
New Haven
and again, Bryan, yeah, thank you. And it's just a
State
suggestion,
road.
Yeah. It's just a suggestion, yeah, just a suggestion. No, she said, I'm going, drive some of the other roads. And I'm saying that respectfully. I mean that honestly, guys. Drive some. You can't go from point A to point B every day without realizing what people are complaining about. And honestly, in all the priorities that I have here sitting as a county commissioner, that's my number one. Because that's the most complaints that I get from my constituents, mm-hmm. are the roads are so bad. And when it happens in Sterling Heights, believe me, I put the hammer down. But I've got 12 other commissioners here I have to contend with who also have problems with their own roads.
Right.
So I'm concerned about Sterling Heights because of the three major roads that you mentioned.
Yes.
And I'm going to be on you like flies on doo-doo just to make sure that those roads get done. And I say it respect.
Thank
no,
you,
I mean
that.
I was impressed when he called me back. Your predecessor never did that. And we have more problems with that gentleman than Carter's got pills. But I appreciate what you did. I think they're probably doing the best they can do. Let's see if we can do a little better.
Definitely.
That's all I have. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Joe.
Usually in the
That's the most I've said ever since I've been a commissioner.
It is. I think you want to go visit his family.
I can tell you what
these are. All right. Commissioner Kraft.
Yeah, many of the commissioners call me through the year. Every, maybe not all of them, but I guarantee almost every one of them. Yeah,
that's
Joe, you're new, and I'm telling you, I always got right back to him. You know, I'm still getting calls from Kathy Bosberg, you know, upstairs. And we just did something the other day.
And she's out of the club now. She doesn't even count.
Yeah.
Don't take her calls anymore.
But Sue does a great job. Bryan will be right on it, but I'm right on it all the time. But again, what you were talking about, the hot patch, once that happens, it holds a lot better, but they're not open yet, the plants.
Okay.
You know, so
thank
the cold
you.
Patch, you're right. It's a bear to keep in there, especially when the temperature changes.
Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. When I previously worked for Congresswoman Miller, I went to M City in Ann Arbor. I have questions about the technology aspect of it. And I sat through one of those tests, the connectivity and all that good stuff. I didn't have the vibrating chair, but I did have the indicators in the car. And I'm interested about financing that technology. I know you said on the presentation here that it would be complete for the county in 2020. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Where does that money come from? Is that federal funds? Does that take away from fixing the potholes or,
no.
or things like that?
No,
is that
totally
a different
separate,
pot of money?
Totally separate fund for traffic operations. Yes.
Okay.
It's not a road funding repair reconstruct type dollar. That's it's CMAQ money. It's considered it's allocated for those type of technologies and grant money that are specific to that type of technology.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Kraft. Commissioner Smith, Chairman Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hi, Bryan, thanks for coming. So I guess it's safe to assume by Commissioner Romano's comments that you drive right into work and never drive the county roads. Okay.
No, that's just my road home
right.
in two words.
Takes
no,
a horse when he's up
I definitely
higher,
I'm just,
travel accounting.
I was just pointing out something here. Anyway, I just had one question for you. The Hall Road project that's going on, there was going to be a 23-mile road project I saw at one point going on at a similar time, which obviously was another same east-west type of major corridor. I heard that was canceled. Was it yours or was it the state's that was going to be doing some major project in there?
We had a project on 21 Mile Road.
Oh, was that
yeah, it was 21 between, I think, Shaner and Romeo Plank or Shaner and Hayes. We're putting that project off. We're reallocating monies. I think we're looking at 2019 for
okay.
that project. So we don't have that conflict of.
And that was why I brought this up. I want to point out how happy I am to hear that, because it seemed like some of that common sense maybe isn't always used. Maybe it wasn't in the past, or maybe sometimes obviously you just can't help where you have to fix things. But mm-hmm. I was very happy to hear that, you know, a lot of people will get off Hall Road and go to 21. The next thing you know, they're stopped up in the same kind of traffic for construction. And it just seemed like it made a lot of sense. And I wanted to, you know, just note how I appreciate that kind of thinking in your department.
Thank you.
That said, a few of the other questions I had were answered. I will agree that Vince Viviano, if it's not Sue at your office, Vince, although he's changed positions, is still the A1 guy. He usually goes out and meets with the people, mm-hmm. and he will, although our commissioner that was most interested in this isn't here to hear it, but Vince will go out and deal with the homeowner, whoever it takes, and he has definitely been an ambassador for your department. I'm sure you realize
definitely
that.
Definitely a valuable asset, that's
right.
For sure.
So anyway, thanks again for being here and doing this, Bryan.
Thank you. You're right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners Kleinfeld.
Thank you, Chair. With respect to the difference between what we actually spend on township maintenance and what we receive compensation for, where is that difference made up?
Basically, our general fund.
Okay, so it's everything else that you have to do takes the hit for that shortage.
Yes, I'm not extremely versed in the budgetary process yet. So I'm unfortunately still green at that side of it. But as far as the allocations, I can look into the history of that and where that actually comes from before I misspeak. So
okay.
I'll definitely look into that.
I've talked about this in the past. The reason that we do townships is because they used to be rural, and now townships have more people in them than a lot of the cities. And so the workload has increased dramatically, and I don't know if the amount of income has increased as dramatically. I don't have that long history. But you guys, because you have to do so much maintenance and even plowing and salting and all of that stuff, you're out in the townships on a regular basis and your eyes are on those roads. Mm-hmm. And I don't think a whole lot of people live like between 8 and 9 mile, probably in your department. So what I want to know is, what is the process for evaluation? Because there are a lot of areas where you don't have eyes on the road unless somebody physically goes down there and takes a look. I talked to you about Hayes. I know as soon as somebody takes a look at it, they're going to say, we can't have this. There's got to be something done about it. What is the process for evaluating the need in county roads?
Well, obviously we have forces that travel in all roads throughout the county. And we do have, service center foreman, assistant foreman that do put together lists for our engineering department to evaluate or look at as far as future potential projects. So, like I said, with the request from the commissioners and their community, as part of that process, as far as projects or need areas, we welcome those, requests also. We will look at whatever roads are necessary or more deteriorated than the others. But there is a process that, we do review it as an engineering department. A county highway engineer relies on the engineers who rely on gathering information from our service center foreman, assistant foreman, as far as roads that, we're looking at moving forward with as far as funding and projects.
Yeah, because we don't have as many county roads down in our area, so you wouldn't have as much reason. And then a lot of the county roads we have, you contract with cities to do some of the work involved, which mean it's less likely that you're in those areas with eyes on the road. And I don't know if those cities report back or not. The part I'm talking about actually splits two cities, so I don't even know who would be responsible for the mm-hmm. road maintenance.
I mean, we do have requests from the cities, towns, or villages,
But you don't have a set plan to go out and evaluate, like, I'm going to evaluate this quadrant and then this quadrant. And that, you don't have a set pattern to go out and evaluate, like, square areas of the county.
I mean, we do have, through SEMCOG and stuff, we do have PACER ratings, which is a road evaluation, analysis of all roadways within the county. And that determines a basis of, excellent, good, fair, and not so good. But
and just plain lousy.
Correct. But basically, there is a process, but, the communities have to be proactive also in getting this information as far as the needs. List also,
okay.
And we do definitely do look at that and do take that in consideration as far as our programs. We want to be able to help out all communities, that have a need. You know, there's a wants list.
We do understand that there's a need to expand in the northern area, so more dollars have to go there, and I think there's an understanding of that. I think my concern is there are some roads that I think you would be addressing quicker if there were eyes on it, and nobody has eyes on it, and that's not just you. The cities mm-hmm. don't have eyes on it. There's just areas where employees in cities don't live, employees in the county don't live. I live. Unfortunately, I don't have a lot of employees around me to evaluate. I think that was it. Yep, that's it. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Pranica. Good questions. Commissioner Leonetti.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good to see you, Bryan. I want to thank you. You know which district I come from. Some of the people there can get around by boat, and they still complain about the roads. And so I do appreciate, in particular, with the Party Bridge, the constituents I've talked to, and the commitments you made to remove that bridge. Most of them are happy. There are some people that are unhappy with it. But the most important thing, you've got 13 commissioners here that represent 65,000 people each. We're all going to whine to you. We're all going to be coming to you with our thing being the most the biggest priority that you should get at. And I want to appreciate, like Commissioner Romano did, that you did get back to me. I wasn't even a commissioner. I was a commissioner-elect, and I was already getting calls about that bridge, mm-hmm. and you gave me a good answer. Since this was an overall presentation, I do have a question. And this comes from my experience with what I've seen in the courtrooms with motor carriers. Maybe you have the answer to this. In my experience in the courtrooms, I've seen motor carriers pay pennies on the dollars for their overloads. I've seen one motor carrier that was fined in the amount of about $120,000. I don't even know how they could have been fined that much. And they walked out of the courtroom with their attorney. It wasn't me, but their attorney ended up with a deal for like $3,000. Now, that's ridiculous because I'll ask you this question with your experience. How much do the motor carriers have an impact on the destruction of our roads or on the impact of these roads?
Definitely significant. I mean, Michigan is, I believe, one of the highest or the highest as far as the weight load limit that per axle. Limit,
number three from the top and almost number three from the bottom in what we get in funding.
Yeah.
Now we're trying to make up for that, obviously, with this happened here. But what you said is true about how some of the fines are negotiated
or
if they're even written up.
If they're even written up. And the question I have is, so let's say we got that $100,000 from that carrier, okay? Where does that money then go to? Because, I've seen it out in New Baltimore. I'm not putting his court on the spot. But does New Baltimore collect those funds and then send it up to the state and then it gets?
I do not know that.
I didn't know if you knew that. Nobody knows. I'll look into that and try to find that out. But
I don't have an answer for you.
But imagine it would go there.
Yeah.
An entity here, and then it would come back down.
I would like to know, and I know you deal with Lansing, you know what I mean, as is your position and city representative, but I think it's something that needs to be looked at is, you know, we all appreciate motor carriers. We are motor carriers, so we rely on them for shipping our cars. I don't want to knock their business, but mm-hmm. I think we could squeeze out a few more funds. It's not much, I'm sure, but it's something, in part because they have the greatest impact on the maintenance of our roads. The, mm-hmm. Their activities are causing our roads to be broken down. We have to spend all this money to pay for it. There has to be a balance. They have to come up a little bit, I think, to help us in maintaining our roads.
And that was part of the presentation as far as alternative funding. I mean, not just gas tax or registration fees or weight taxes. I mean, it's looking at different avenues to gain more funding to support our road system.
Thanks, Bryan. Good to see you.
Thank you, too.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Leonetti. Commissioner yes. Carabelli.
Thank you. A couple of real quick things. I can't see. Oh, I apologize. I did mention Sue and communication, but point blank, to reiterate what Chairman Bob Smith had said, you had left the room. He has been nothing but responsive. He's been out there to take care of issues that, God bless him, and I'm so grateful that he had to go out there. And he will do it
in a good way.
Morning, day, and night. So first of all, I was remiss by not mentioning you as well as Sue. So
no, I just meant.
No, I know you're not looking for it, but I want to let the other commissioners know they have an issue to get a hold of you as well.
Absolutely.
On the second point, Commissioner Kleinfeld brought some great points about the municipalities, but I want to point a few things out here. In the municipalities, they cost share on every project that's out there. They cost share on all the projects. Sometimes 60%, 40%, 20%, depending on what it is. Now, when the federal funds come in for a 20% match and there's another 20 that has to be covered, they're coming out big out of these municipalities in the north. So don't think that they're getting these projects for free. Shelby Township sets up an SAD in every one of the communities. Cities can do the same thing, that we turn around and repave interior subdivisions that are 40 years old, but the residents pay for it, and we hire the road commission or road department to do the work and to regulate it and make sure it's done. When I had mentioned about the crack fill, let me just really quick, and I apologize, and I'm not trying to belabor this. If you crack fill a road, an average life of a road is what, 10 years, 20 years?
Concrete, 20 to 25 is, okay. is the proposed
lifespan. And the thought is if you have a crack in it and you spend pennies and you crack it, seal it every year, you can add possibly up to 10 years onto that life. So my big push is, because we don't have money to put in all new roads in every community, is to maximize the crack sealing program so we can have longevity in what we currently have. It's a Band-Aid. The reality is, what was it, 6 years ago, we were talking about pulverizing streets because we couldn't afford to take care of them. Throughout the state of Michigan, streets were pulverized back to gravel because they couldn't resurface them and take care of them. So we've come leaps and bounds. He doesn't have enough money to do what they do. And there is a list that they have. Municipalities hire their own private engineering firms, and they grade their roads, interior roads, and the roads are responsible for, and they have the grading. One being great, 10 being the worst, and you can imagine where a lot of them are, and that's why they spend the money and the list is forwarded on. The TIP program is also a grading system, so when he goes through and he asks for his programs, his engineers actually have, there's a grading program. I sat on it, and they turn around, and every road is done. It's not like, hey, he's my political buddy, I want to move this up. No, there's all engineering involved. These projects are put into order of how those are getting done. So there is a program to that, and I just wanted to touch on that, to mention it. And again, I really would like to have that little thing you have in your car to make all the lights turn green. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you very much for coming down. We appreciate it, and we'll be in touch.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Sooner than later, probably. Thank you, Bryan. Need a motion. Motion's been made and supported. All those in favor say aye. All vote. Yeah. We got to vote because we haven't forbid. Thank you.
Bryan's never coming down here again.
Up again.
Item.
Commissioner Romano and Commissioner Drolet still need a vote.
Well, Leanne's not there. Vote for Commissioner.
No.
All right. Very good. It passed.